Welcome to the Totally Awesome Fishing Show. Well, I'm down here in the heart of Hampshire on the Hampshire Avon, which a load of you river guys obviously know is one of the most famous, probably is the most famous southern river, you know, for barbel, chub, dace, roach, pike, mixed fishing, big sea trout they used to get down here. I remember getting pictures of guys off the Ringwood Club, used to get some big sea trout down there as well. I'm down here, I'm going to try some dace fishing. Now, it's not great conditions as far as I'm concerned. The conditions have changed since I came down here a few days ago. And it's up, it's pushing a bit, but they tell me there's a little side stream here where the dace can back up and be really, really good dace fishing. Not just for numbers of dace, but some real big ones, and that's what we're looking for. Hampshire Avon is known for quality, and I'm going to be talking with Richard. Now, Richard is the owner of Ringwood Tackle Shop, which has been here God knows how long, 30 years or something. Now, Richard, give us a little bit of a run through on what guys can do if they're coming down here. How would they set up to get started for what is, no question about it, quality dace fishing?
Well, Graham, really, the river's not pushing as bad as we thought it was going to be today.
Yeah.
A little bit more, but you should be fine with little floats like this. The tributary you're fishing, just in front of the shop, is quite steady. I saw a gentleman out there earlier catching some nice herring dace. Yep. Hopefully, it's going to be cock on for you.
Okay.
Just fishing with a bit of red and white maggot, little and often, everything should be good.
Now, these floats here, what would you call these? Like a wire stem
A wire stem Avon. Drunin have made these for donkey's years. Still a massive seller for us on the side streams and such. As something like this, 3BB, just perfect.
Would they work on the main river? You said the side stream.
River, no. You'll probably be looking something like, rather than 3BB, you're probably looking for something like five swan shot. Yeah, one of those real big ones. It almost looks like a pike float.
Because it's like boily and swirly.
The Avon boils from the bottom upwards.
Yes.
In a lot of places, so you need something to have your weight, you know, the bait right down to the bottom. So you bulk shot it right down.
Yes.
Today you won't need to.
Yeah.
You
yeah.
could shirt button sort of style it. Everything will be fine. Yeah.
And now, what shot are these ones going to take?
These are taking 3BB.
That's all you want.
Yeah, that's all you're going to need.
Yeah.
Three of them. Nice little 18.
Yeah. Yeah. Now, barbless are making a difference here.
No, there's where you're fishing, there is no barbed or barbless rules, so it's whatever you want. These are micro barbs, so they'll be fine.
Okay, so
when those dates start twisting in such as, you might want a small barb on to keep them on.
I've got you. So 16s, 18s, that's all you're going to want.
16s and 18s, perfect. 18s probably start off, you know, there's quite a wide gate, that one. 18, yeah. You'll get two maggots on, that'd be perfect.
Okay, okay. Do you get any chub in that size stream, or not really?
You get the odd chub.
Yeah.
You've got a chance. Recently, there's some nice roach been coming out amongst them.
Yeah.
So that could be a little bonus.
Okay.
Now and again, you'll be playing a lovely dace. Then all of a sudden, it's going to go rock hard and go downstream. You're going to hook to pike. But
my friend, the pike, and I bought no pike gear. But listen, the tackle shop's here. I'll soon come in and buy something.
Good.
Hook links, what would you say?
That reflow power line's very good. You're just going to go a slight lower diameter than when your main line. Very good stuff.
Is that relatively new? I've not heard of that one.
No, I think Powerline's probably been out probably nearly 10 years now.
It's amazing.
Really good stuff. So you tie your hook onto that, probably something like a 12-inch hook link to a micro swivel.
Yes.
To your main line, shot just above the swivel. Perfect.
Now, you just mentioned something there, which I don't. I just use loop to loop, but you're saying a micro swivel now.
I would use a micro swivel because where you're maggot fishing and you're reeling it back, quite often the maggot's spinning in the water, twisting your hook link up. You know what it's like? You're hooked an island, you put out and change your maggot, it whizzles up, twizzles up. Micro swivel stops that.
Is that right?
End of the dace or whatever it's turning. It just stops everything tangling. Perfect.
Listen, I'm going to take my glasses. And his glasses. You want to see it? You want to see how small these things are? I've got no chance. No
Perfect.
Chance. Now, what is this one? Is that main line or is that another?
That's your main line. That's what you'll probably be using. That's the Drennan Supplex. That probably come out 18 months ago. A lot of the lads like it.
Yes.
Especially for pin on the centre pin.
Yeah.
Quite low
now,
diameter.
Now, they fish that straight through, would they?
Yeah, quite a lot of the lads go straight through.
That's
yeah.
4 pounds.
Yeah, but it's only a 0.16 diameter.
Yeah. And this one is, the hooking one is...
That is 0.11 diameter. Which is breaking at 3.6.
3.6,
really thin stuff. So you definitely will have to put a couple of pairs of glasses on.
Is that a pre-stretched or anything like that?
Yeah, there's a little bit of play in it still.
Yeah.
But it's not like a bit of Maxima, which you will just keep stretching.
Stretching. Okay, well, we'll give it a go there anyway.
So what you can do.
It's going to be what, a couple of feet deep, something like on average?
Yeah, you're going to be looking, foot and a half, couple of foot.
And the feed-wise, Every run
little
through?
And often, yeah. Just keep flicking, you know, like a pinch of maggot every time.
Okay, we'll give it a go. Okay.
Yeah, a couple of pint of maggots should last you.
Colour wise, is it a mix of red and white?
What majority of the customers are using red and white maggot.
We'll give it a go. Fingers crossed, we catch on it. Thanks
Hopefully.
Very much, then, Richard.
Hopefully, it'll be good. Good luck,
Thank
Grant.
You. The thing is, with the main river absolutely barreling down in a flood, and listen, you can see the swirls there, so you know that it's not going to be a great fishing. It's a wide, big river. It's powerful. And looking right back down here, you can see even around the edges, it's swirling. It's the flood water has been right through there. It's scouring everything out. And you'd think, really, other than ledger, it wouldn't be any good. But here's some of the species that you can get down here on the Hampshire Avon. Barbel, perch, chub, you name it. It's one of the most, well, it probably is the most famous river in the south. Okay, it's not what it used to be years ago, 30, 40 years ago, but hey, what river is? But down at Ringwood Tackle, that's the place to go. Pick up your bait, and more important, guys, pick up the information on when and where to fish. Well, guys, it's really noisy here right on the motorway. I don't know if you're going to hear this at all, but first trot down, and I'm into a dace already. It's a really nice fish. Just look at the size of this. This is a stamp of Hampshire Avon dace. But do you know what's unusual about this? That's what will bother me. That stab mark in the back, is that from a cormorant or a heron? I don't know. Double white maggots on there. But you can definitely see, I'll show it to you if I can, because it's important that all river fishermen realise the predation is going on. A big chunk out the back of that. Could have been an otter grabbing at it, who knows. Not good news for river fishing, but lovely little fish, let's get it back. Well, here you can see part of the main river. It's not actually a major side stream, but it's still going through pretty fast. It's pretty pacey. You've got to learn visually to pick out the correct pockets or runs where the fish are. Now here, there was another guy fishing up there. He was going pike fishing. He was just trying to get some bait, trotting down there. And he said, drop in there. He's been feeding there as well. We've been getting the odd bite going through, picking up the odd fish. And you can see it's a much smoother flow there. But look at the river here. It's between 7 and 8. Let's call that 7.5, whatever, inches, feet, whatever the measurement is. Remember that, because I'm only there for like half, 3/4 of a day. You do not want to be fishing on a rising river. You really get the best fishing, especially on the Hampshire Avon chalk streams, on a river that's been flooded and is falling, because that's when the fish are going to be hungry. And it doesn't take me long to get in action again. Nice prime Hampshire Avon dace. I've never even fished here before. No, it's not a private stretch, far from it. It's a great stretch to fish, but more important, those fish have backed up from the main river and gone up that side stream. Brilliant action for anybody who wants to put the time and the bait in. Well, people, you want to see this dace. This is an absolute, as Richard said in the tackle shop, been a bit closer for you, that's a herring. Look at the size of it. That is my biggest dace so far this season. What a beauty. And do you know what, at the moment, the way they're taking, they've obviously get fish for quite a bit. A fish like that, well, what can I say? That's what you come to the Hampshire Avon for. Absolute beauty. Well, now the Hampshire Avon years ago used to be known as a big barbel and chub river, and indeed they still do get big barbel and chub, but nothing like the numbers they used to get years ago. However, what it does appear to have is a very good head of dace in the Ringwood area. They get some nice dace, some nice roach, good mixed fishing. You could put them in a keep net, I guess, if you wanted, but I don't bother much now. You just catch them, release them, that's what the sport is all about. But with flood water fishing, you can see here, remember that fast swirling stretch of the main river in those earlier opening shots. You can see here that actually, yes, I'm catching fish, but the pace of the river is nice, smooth, and constant. It's coloured. Normally, this will be absolutely gin clear, especially in the summer, full of weed, very, very low, and possibly unfishable. But in the winter, with the extra pace of river that goes up in there, the fish back up. It's up to you to feed them and try and get them out if you can. Well, I got snagged on the bottom and I got it freed off. It's just give me an idea to give you a bit of a totally awesome tip. The next three drops down, I had two bites, two fish on, and two fish bumped off. I thought, that's strange, I've been catching quite regularly. And I reckon that the point of the hook here had just got turned over, what I call specked over. Now you can tell that because the few times after that, when I was trying to hook the maggot on, obviously I hook it by the fat end first, and I noticed the hook was having a lot of trouble good popping through the skin. Now this is a new one, straight through. I can roll it around, and what I do is hold the bottom of the bend. I pop the maggot over the top of the eye of the hook just to hold it, and then I just put one maggot through the fat end. Some people turn it around so it doesn't spin, but if you use those micro swivels, apparently it doesn't spin. And that way, it's totally, totally covered the hook. Because this stretch is pretty well fished, pretty well hammered, and I'm catching, and I'm gonna tell you another tip in a minute. So if you do start bumping fish off, especially dace, you've gotta what they call dot those bites. As soon as that float goes down, you're gonna pop the rod top, not hard, just enough to set the hook. When you start bumping fish off, just be aware that you might have had a little, just turned a little speck off the point of the hook. It's not sharp, cut it off, put it in your box, make sure you don't use it again, and tie a fresh hook on. I'm going back in again, another handful of maggots. I tell you what, I'm on fire. Call the fire engine. Another tip, if you can hear it over the road here, if you remember, I retied that hook and I must have lost 3 inches there. So because I've lost 3 inches off the hook link by tying another hook on, remember to move your float up another 3 inches, and I reckon that could get me a fish. Something as simple as remembering that you might have had a snap off, a break off, you might have changed the hook link, you might have actually changed the hook like I told you. Something as simple as that, when you actually realise, oh yeah, I've lost 3 or 6 inches off that hook length, therefore in floodwater conditions your bait held by the float, suspended by the float, is going through over the heads of those fish rather than down level with them. And remember, it's coloured water, it's brown. If it's more than 6 inches, well, I'm saying 6 inches, it might even be 3 inches. If it's more than 3 inches away from their face, they can't see it. They don't know it's there. It's up to you to build that swim and to get that bait right in the face of the fish. And here we go again, dace after dace after dace. Where's a different one, people? There is gudgeon. And that was where I've actually gone a little bit over depth, just tripping the bottom looking for a bigger dace, and like a little baby barbel, and there are big barbel down here in several, so I don't think they're in this side stream though. There he is, and I changed to double red maggot, giving that a try. So I've had another couple of dace and the gudgeon on red maggot. So they take red, they take white. I'll persevere a little while longer, I think, with the red maggot. I'll put him back, and hopefully a pike doesn't eat him, because there's a bit of pike swirling down there as well. Well, I've been getting plenty of dace going through there, but the size has dropped from those first few big ones I got. And although they say don't put any ground bait in, I'm going to try some ground bait, and I brought some with me. This is, I think it's a Bailey's number one or something. It's a like a polo feed, very high quality polo horses. This is not polo the mince that you eat, this is polo the horses that run around and you hit balls with great big long sticks, that type of polo. So it's good quality because they're expensive horses and they like to feed them on really good feed, and this is good stuff. And it's cheap, very, very cheap. Don't get it from anywhere but agricultural horse feed suppliers, so you can always track it down on the internet. I'm going to mix some of this up because that way it bonds up quite a bit. I want to get down so it's all breaking up and trundling along the bottom. And this, I feel, being a bit sticky when you put it together, will take those maggots along the bottom quicker, you know, because don't forget, it's not in total flood, but it's high water, and that's why I'm fishing this side stream. So I want to try and get the maggots down, and I feel I'm going through 3/4 depth, something like that, and that's why I'm getting the small to average sort of size dace. And I'm after a couple of chunkers, of real big ones. Here comes a motorbike. I think that's why I'm getting these small dace now, is because the maggots are going through quite fast. Maybe I'll go and look at that meter and see if the level has actually risen, and that's why it's a little bit fast, I don't know. But I feel that's what it's doing it. I'm going through, you know, the maggots. I can get down with the float in the maggot because I've got shot on the float, haven't I? I can get my bait down, but I can't get the feed down unless it's right down the back of the swim. So I want to try and concentrate them in the first third, and therefore mix this up wet, and then I put my maggots in there, and I'll show you how to get it down. Little pellet-sized balls. We're going to try it. Hey ho, come on, it's a totally awesome fishing show. We try anything old school. Let's see if it still works. Well, it worked 30, 40 years ago. I'm pretty sure it's going to work now. One of the most important things about mixing your ground bait, especially this horse feed I use, is to do it in small measurements of water. Don't just fill up that container, bucket, washing up bowl, whatever you're going to use. Just dab a bit of water in there. Mix it around and around. You want to spread it. You want to allow those grains of whatever ground bait you're using to actually soak up, to absorb the water. That will help them expand. Make sure you use your fingers to really work that water right through the ground bait, right through to the bottom, because very often you think you've made it wet and it's actually dry at the bottom. There's nothing more annoying when the fish are on the feed and you're feeding it in little pellets, little balls, and it suddenly goes dry and you've got to stop to go, you know, put some more water in to damp it up. Add some maggots. Squeeze and squash them in. But remember, they're going to break up. They're going to wiggle around and break up any balls of ground bait as well. And you want them to do that down near the river bed where the fish are. The other thing is, if you leave them and you don't use them for, say, 10 or 15 minutes, those maggots will naturally wriggle down through the ground bait, get to the bottom. So turn it over every now and then. Get the maggots from the bottom to the top of the mix. Make up these little pellets. I'm going to say, what, golf ball size? Now I'm just dragging the float in the current. This is about the level you want to get. Accuracy if you can. I'm only doing this to show you how close you've got a line, what we call a line of bait going down, and that's where you want your float running down. This ground bait, this horse feed, this polo horse feed is really good for breaking up. And also if you squeeze it hard, it will go down to the riverbed and trundle along and even anchor on the bottom there. If you squeeze it loosely, just loosely together, as it impacts on the water, it will explode, and then that spreads a nice cloud going down through the water quite slowly. Follow that up straight away with your maggot, with your float. Swing it out, cast it out. My goodness, that is a totally awesome, perfect cast. It went right over where those ground bait balls went in. That's where you want it, and then you're going to drop that float all the way down. If you keep it on the same line, you should come up with fish like this. Just look at the quality of this big dace I'm returning. It's absolutely superb to catch fish like this, but the rivers in England and indeed all around Britain are under pressure. Make no mistake, they are not what they are. There are pockets of good fishing and we should preserve it if we can find it, look after it, maintain it, maybe keep stocking densities up and keep predators like cormorants and stuff. If we can get a change to the law, so much the better, and you'll get superb fishing like this once again. Well folks, this is a turn up for the books. It looks like the heavens are about to open again, and different species this time. Can you guess what it is before I show you? There we go. A nice Hampshire Avon roach. Nice looking fish. Well, spanking condition. And I've gone back to the white maggots. And do you know what that ground bait in? That seems to have done the trick. Slightly better sized dace I'm getting now, and obviously decent roach as well. So it's just a little tip there, just small amounts of ground bait. I'm just using that horse feed and it's getting it down, it's getting those maggots down to where my bait is actually trundling along the bottom, and that's where I want it. Flood water conditions are not going to be high in the water, you're going to be down low, and that's where you want to be with your bait. Let's get this guy back. Remember, to minimise any movement to that float, you have to mend the line. If you watch this as a belly in the line, the float's facing downstream, so just gently lift the line and put the float back in position. As it goes down, you're ready to strike, and you should get the fish hooked up okay. Just remember to keep the movement from your rod tip to that float to the absolute minimum. Just let it go down if you can at the pace of the river, and try and get it so the bait is just tripping along the riverbed. Maybe just barely a foot or two above, that's all you need. And you can see there, you get a little V, a little wake off the float as you gently try and mend the line between the rod top and the float. There's quite an art in it, trying to keep it to go down at a constant speed. Here it's easier, because although the river is running fast, or relatively fast, it's nice and flat, it's not swirly, there's no change in the currents, it's probably going through at a constant speed, therefore it makes float fishing really a little bit easier. Well, I'm getting almost every third or fourth drop down. Nice big dace now, I've put that little bit of ground bait in there. There we go. Couldn't ask better than that. So I think that gives you some little tips there. You've got to go in these small side streams. Years and years ago, they were the places to go when there was flood water running. It's starting to rain again now. Coming across really dark. I'm not going to call it a day, but I think I have to call it a day for filming. But look at the size of this dace. And they say you can get 30 pounds of them in here in a good day, in some of these side streams. Check out all side streams, ask some of the locals, don't neglect them. They're a great, well, it's a great place to go fishing anyway, and it's a great method. Float fishing for dace. Brilliant. I've had a great day for a change. I was saying I was just about to pack up because the rain was coming through. The rain cloud's been and gone, and obviously I fished on. I thought I'll go down the bottom of the swim, just walk down, because some of that ground bait might have gone right down the bottom and been missed by the first fish. Man alive, you want to see the dace and roach I've been catching. Some of the best big dace fishing I think I've ever had on the Hampshire Avon. I've got a few in my landing net. This is in about a dozen or 12, 15 trots down. And I've got these already. They are ka-chunking great big fish. I've got to show them to you, just to so you can see the idea of what real quality Hampshire Avon fish look like. Now it's noisy here, but just look at the size of this catch here. I'm just going to bring them up. I'm going to put them on the towel, in fact, for you. I haven't got to a dace weighing mat or anything, but you want to see some of these fish. Look at the size of those. And in amongst them, lovely great big roach here. Huge dace. One of the dace is just monumental. That cannot be far off of 12, 14 ounces, that fish here. I would think at least. Look at the size of that one. That is an absolute animal. Beautiful catch of dace there. And that was just right at the bottom end of the swim. One roach. In fact, you can go back, chum. You're not big enough to be in this picture. Just look at those fish. Absolutely pristine, spanking, beautiful bars of silver. You see here the flow. Now you wouldn't ordinarily think, looking at that main river that's absolutely barreling and churning along there, as you can see in the distance, it's really ripping along closer in up this side stream, a nice even smooth pace. But look at the measurements early on. If you remember, it was at 7.5. Now after something like 4 hours fishing, this is why I'm starting to catch all these fish like that. It's dropped down to 7. So it's what I said earlier, it is actually a falling river, and that is a condition that turn a lot of species on. It could be big fish like barbel, chub, could be big roach, or it could be a regular fish, dace, gudgeon. That sort of stuff's going to give you the action, perch. So look for, if you can, falling river conditions. That should get you some totally awesome action. Go at that point that bit me off. This time the odds might be a bit different. Fish on, people, big time. Always, if you're an all-round angler, put a wire trace with a single hook in your match tackle box. I've got the pike hooked up, see if we can get him out. What a day's fishing I'm having. It's not supposed to go into a roach net there. Totally awesome fishing at its best, guys. There you go. Pike, roach, monster dace, and a little gudgeon. Well, listen, since signing off last time, I'm absolutely blinded 2 hours fishing with jumbo, roach, dace, everything. It's been really, really good. And that pike, I mean, you know me and pike guys, one little dead, tiny little dead dace I don't mind sacrificing. First, second, well, it was about third twitch down, boom, he nailed it. This time, wire trace, job done, caught and released. Well, my ears are ringing from the traffic. It's going past, it's getting really busy now, the light's fading. I'll probably go back on, I might squeeze, I don't know, another 15 minutes fishing out of it. I just can't leave, you just can't go when the fish is this good. Probably one of the best little sessions I've had. And there you go, side stream fishing, totally awesome fishing. And you know what, you really should give it a crack in floodwater conditions. Get out those little streams and creeks and everywhere like that, because that's where the fish hide a lot of the time. And it shows you, if those bait fish are there, dace, roach, gudgeon, the predators, the pike won't be far behind. See you next time, and don't forget to watch the totally awesome outdoor show as well. There's going to be some tips on there. Not fishing, but listen, there's stuff other than fishing, isn't there? No?